And I'm just going to refresh to see whether we are actually live.
I think we might be, because
I
I
think
can
we
see
are.
us.
Yeah, and I've got to mute. I always forget to mute that one. There we go. Welcome everyone to another exciting edition of the Magic Sandwich Show, number 104, if those figures are to be believed. And I've really got to change my opening. I've been saying that for the last 50 shows. So I think I've got to come up with something new. But it's a huge pleasure to welcome onto the show Hogtie, a regular, and also for the first time, Vadim. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thanks for having me.
I'm hoping also, and I'm just going to take a moment to check with those that are in the audience. My audio on the last few times that we've done Vaughan TV has been very low. Is my audio acceptable now? And why am I getting adverts? I thought I had Adblock Plus. Why is Vaughan showing adverts? I don't know. Someone respond to me. I am loud and clear. Oh, and bored to bits. Thank you so much for being here. Let me just explain to people. I've spent the last week travelling around England with R&R, who's on a sort of like a European trip at the moment. I picked him up from Manchester last Saturday and have spent the last week basically being his taxi driver, I guess. That's the best way of putting it. But we've had an enormous amount of fun. And on our trip, one of the people we met was actually bored to bits. And there he is in the chat. So it was a great pleasure to meet you. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. I'm not sure. I'll perhaps leave a little bit of that till later, but we'll crack on with the main show. As ever, if you want to join us, please send a Skype contract request to Magic Sandwich Show. We'll see if we can get you on. We've got a particular topic that we want to talk about, and this comes out of a conversation I had on Skype with Vadim last night, who I met for the first time. Pleasure to meet you, and he was talking about the peer review process. And I thought, hey, why not, rather than me try and explain it, why not get you on the show and get someone who actually knows a little bit about it, which is Hogtiechamp. So perhaps we can kick off, Vadim, with what your question was. What do you want to ask?
There's a few kind of, I guess, aspects of the peer review system that I'd like to explore. And I think an appropriate way to kind of start out is actually to give you a little bit of background on kind of, what my, I guess, my first familiarity with the peer review system was. Basically, about around 2009, maybe 2008. I guess you could say that I first came to the whole atheist slash skeptic community, or just way of thinking, through the atheist experience. And the reason why I found it was because I had encountered these conspiracy theories about 9/11, and I just knew that they had to be kind of crap, but I didn't really have any way to verify that. So I got on YouTube and I found these clips from the atheist experience. And one of the many points that Matt Dillahunty made to the callers that called in, because a lot of these people, these folks, were making claims that the engineers from the truther movement had discovered like thermite and other things. And he basically kept on coming back to, if that was true, they should be able to verify it through legitimate peer review and get it published through a respectable journal. And I have to admit, that was actually the first time that I had ever really encountered the concept of the peer review system. I did not know that it existed. And to tell you the truth, I mean, immediately I thought this is a really fantastic point that he's making. And I very quickly kind of thought about it and I thought, like, wow, I think it's really pretty strange that, I mean, I I went to decent schools. I wasn't a straight A student, but I did pretty well. And I thought it was pretty strange that I had gone I also graduated from college. I went to an arts college, so it's kind of understandable that maybe I wouldn't have learned about it there. But I think that, you know, that it would be it should be an essential thing that we're taught within schools, because it seems like, you know, if we know kind of why, we can trust the knowledge that the scientific community has built upon, then, you know, I just think that perhaps we'd see less incidents of people believing all sorts of, you know, incorrect things, like everything from, you know, the kind of anti-evolution things that you guys typically deal with to climate change denial and things like that. So I'd like to, one, you know, explore that idea. Why isn't it taught and shouldn't it be? And then on top of that, I'd love for you guys to, you know, really elaborate, because although I've learned a lot more about it, I feel like, you know, I still kind of have a layman's understanding of it. And I'd like to know from, you know, your point of view, just why is it such a great mechanism? Why is it something that allows us to trust the, you know, the knowledge that we have and things like that. So now that I've said all that, I'll throw it out to you guys.
Hogtai, I've got various points, and indeed a video clip that I want to play in relation to this. But do you want to kick off?
Yeah. Okay. I'll do it light then. I'll keep it short. I'd like that. I mean, the framing of that question, that issue is just great. I would throw in your list of, like, you're sort of saying that there are many different areas of investigation, whether it's climate change or moon landing hoaxes, or you focused on 9/11. And I will say I was actually briefly fooled by the whole 9/11 conspiracy thing and the thermite. I had a weekend of really severe flu, and I probably took too much cold medication, and I watched a bunch of videos on YouTube about thermite. This is about 2006. And after a couple hours, I was convinced, you know, and luckily I got better. But I would throw on that list the anti-vax movement, because this is another issue, another area of an enterprise of investigation, right? I mean, we've got this idea that you can take, you know, chemicals or you know, bacteria or viruses or whatever, and mix them in a thing and stick them in children's arms, and that's a good thing or a bad thing for their health, right? There might be mercury in it. Maybe that's a good thing or a bad thing for their health. These are all empirical questions that ought to be addressed through empirical investigation and then reported correctly through through the peer-reviewed media. And so I would throw that on the list as well. I'll say, as kind of a banner statement, one thing I'd be really cautious about, there's one thing you said that I don't like and one thing you said that I really like. So I'll say the thing you said I really like. You said, so I'm wondering why it isn't taught. I thought, man, that would be such a simple thing to add to basic science education, even at the high school level, you know, we don't teach high school students the nuts and bolts of everybody's job. Like, they get an idea of what doctors do, but they don't realize how much paperwork there is, for example, and nobody cares. But for scientists, the communication of ideas is such a essential pillar of what a scientist does with their day, that it really ought to be taught. Like, so, you know, we say, well, like, well, here's what we're learning about science. Here's our understanding of science itself. And science includes the discovery of new ideas, obviously, you know, through empirical investigation, and the communication of those ideas to one's peers, in this case through a peer-reviewed media network, and three, the sort of passing the torch, creating a generation of new scientists through graduate school and things like that. And we don't really talk about that, and it's something that could be introduced even with brevity at the high school level. The one thing you said, and I don't think it was really awful, but it's just the thing that I'm a little nervous about when I hear non-believers say, is the thing about, well, so why is it so good? Like, why is peer review so incredibly awesome? Like, you know, why should we revere peer review? I'm completely misrepresenting what you said, of course. But I want to do that as a cautionary note, before we proceed with DPR's points in the video, and then I can sort of put more flesh on this a little bit later. But one thing I've heard happening on the Atheist Experience, and when I watch Hangouts younger atheists going into Hangouts and very snidely saying, well, it's in the peer-reviewed literature. Show me a peer-reviewed article. And the creationists are picking up on this. They start saying, oh, well, you guys revere peer review. You have faith in peer review. And there's nothing divine about peer review. It's markedly imperfect. There's a on a totally unrelated topic, there's a fairly famous quotation of Churchill, who actually claims to be quoting someone else, about democracy, right? Churchill had actually written initially, indeed, it has been said that democracy is the worst form of government, except for all those other forms that have been tried from time to time. So I want to suggest to you that peer review is the worst form of how to filter ideas for good ideas from bad ideas and disseminate it to other people, except for every other way we've tried doing it. So I want to try to take peer review down a peg in people's minds, because the people who participate in the process don't have any false illusions about it somehow being a perfect filter for truth.
Sure, but if something cannot get peer reviewed from, like, you know, a decent journal, then is that not a, like, you know, like a red flag, a huge red flag?
Wait, actually, that's a good question, a quick one. I can answer. Let's think about type 1 and type 2 errors. And again, I do want to leave the door open, because I know DPR had some comments in a video clip.
That's all right. You take your time. My video can wait.
Well, let's think about, so anytime you have a filtering process, you're and just for the simplicity of it, let's say that there's good things and bad things. Let's keep it nice and binary. There's actual helpful information that's accurate and useful and will help build the enterprise of science. And then there's the hokum bullshit, right, that gets done. You know, the bands, the magnetic fields and whatever else, crystals, that sort of thing. And then you've got a filtering process where the intent of the filter is let the good stuff through and to trap and discard the bad stuff. So anytime you have a system like that, whether it's medical screening or hypothesis testing or anything like that, you end up getting four things, right? You get the correct acceptance of an idea, or the correct rejection of a bad idea, or you get the type 1 and type 2 errors. So the type 1 error would be the mistaken acceptance of a bad idea. A type 2 error would be the mistaken rejection of a good idea. And I would say that when you look at the what you get when you actually thumb through the journals, is you have an awful lot of good ideas, a lot of, it's a pretty good system. You have the majority of the information you get is good, but some bad stuff does get through just because something has been promoted for peer review, but not much. I would say it's very, very minimal. I would say the biggest failing of peer review is it tends to block more good stuff than let bad stuff through. So let me try to distill that down, and maybe that is the one sentence distillation. In terms of the type 1 and type 2 errors, I think that the peer review process historically has been kind of over-filtering. It makes it even difficult to get even good ideas through. So just because something's been blocked by peer review doesn't necessarily mean that it represents a bad idea, because there's a lot of that happening. Now, to a much lesser extent, when things do get through peer review, sometimes they're wrong, but really not very often. So what was your question? Your question was about the barrier. If you have a bad idea and you try to get it published, you're pretty much certainly not going to get it published through peer review.
What would you say, Hogtie? Because I've got, as you're aware, I've got some comments to make about the peer review process, but what if your idea is incredibly novel and goes against the mainstream understanding of the body of evidence at the time? Peer review, you're saying, could actually block a brilliant idea. I'm thinking, for example, of Einstein and his theories and whatever. I mean, did he go through peer review process?
Yeah, all the time. Now, there've been one of the things that's going to happen, we can sort of talk about the generality of peer review, and then as we talk about it, we're going to have to start saying, oh, but it used to be this way and it used to be that way. There was a time when, when Einstein was submitting papers for peer review, they would contact, well, we talked about the process at some point too, that what is peer review? You get a list of referees, usually two or three or four other scientists in the field or related fields that will review the manuscripts and suggest revisions. And then you get instructions back from the editorial board on whether to revise, resubmit, or get lost. Those referees in Einstein's day would have received an envelope with a manuscript that had blah, 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 some physics, complicated physics thing, Albert Einstein and name of institution, like so. So they would have known they were reviewing a paper by Einstein. If they didn't like Einstein, which initially he was not well received, he would have had trouble getting things through. But after he got to be known as just so incredibly brilliant, I bet you he had a lot easier time getting even bad ideas through. Now, where it's different now is that the majority of peer review research journals do not tell, like the editor knows who's submitting, but you have to submit what's called the masked copies, identity masked copies. So you send a copy for editorial review that has your name and research institute affiliation, and then you send one that doesn't have that information, send three copies of that for the referees. So when you get them now, I mean, Einstein, if were he alive, could write a paper now, and he'd have it reviewed by the same process as some dorky second-year grad student in physics. So, but yeah, I to answer your question more directly, I think that there are a lot of novel ideas that don't get through the peer review process because the referees look at it and they just go, wow, this is cuckoo.
Well, this may be... Oh. I'm sorry, do go on.
Well, I just wanted to explore, an argument that lots of 9/11 conspiracy theorists and conspiracy theorists in general make about their particular topic, whatever it is that, you know, that they that there is kind of like a hierarchy. Either the top... that funding will be taken away if they say, you know, if they publish things that are, you know, just deemed, just, you know, against the norm or what have you. And that's why these, you know, 9/11 truthers can't get published in a legitimate journal. How much merit do you think that argument has?
I don't think it has any, and I think it's a one. I think it's a wonderful segue into the video clip that I had set up for this, and I wasn't aware that you were going to specifically refer to 9/11. I certainly wasn't aware that Hogtiechamp was going to refer to 9/11. But the clip that I've got actually comes from a series of videos that I did about the 9/11 incident and the conspiracy theories that came out of it. And having made, I think, four, perhaps five videos and received extraordinary hostility and abuse from several sections of society, I said, look, okay, I've addressed all of the major issues. If there's anything you want me to address, just... let me know. And someone messaged me and they said, I'd like you to address a peer-reviewed paper that was published by, I think, if memory serves me right, about nine people. And so I did. I did two videos on it. But one of them actually dealt with the publication in which they chose to reveal what, if they were correct about, was evidence of the greatest conspiracy of modern age. And they chose a very bizarre journal. And I have to apologize. As I say, I've been away, and I was trying desperately to prepare everything. I think that I have got it set at the right part of the video, but I apologize if I haven't. What you will have to do, Hogtie and Vadim, is to mute yourself on the Skype call and actually listen to it on Vaughan TV. It'll take me perhaps a couple of seconds to get this set up, hopefully no more, and we'll see where we go from there. Okay.
I'm not exactly sure how to mute Skype.
Okay.
Either of you?
Yeah. If you hold your mouse anywhere over the video box, there should be a few icons pop up at the bottom.
Yeah.
One of which is a microphone, and if you click on that,
yeah,
you've muted yourself.
Yeah, he does not mean, sorry to clarify, he doesn't mean to mute the audio through Skype. He means just to mute your own microphone.
Yeah.
So that when you, as you listen to the video, it won't, we've got headphones now anyway, so.
Yeah. Right. Hopefully you can listen to Vaughn TV now.
Yeah, just go up on the volume on Vaughn, which I am, and good to go.
Okay, I'm pressing play now.
The website for that organization is somewhat lacking in detail, so I used the contact us function, and I did get a response. I'll come back to that later. Bearing in mind that the conclusion that they reach in this paper basically uncovers one of the greatest conspiracies the world has ever known, where do they go in order to publicize their findings? The Open Chemical Physics Journal. This, it has to be said, is an interesting choice. And by interesting, I mean not only are the contents of the paper not appropriate for a journal purporting to cover that topic, but I also mean it in a totally and deliberately sarcastic way. The journal is nothing short of a joke, despite having an editorial board of 90 or so people from throughout the world. In 2009, the journal published 4 papers. To give you some idea of how staggering this is, YouTube user Thunderfoot has published, on average, 4 papers a year. But perhaps what is more interesting is the account given by Philip Davies, a graduate student of Cornell University. This article appeared in The New Scientist in September of last year. I'll pick it up at the beginning of the second paragraph. Earlier this year, Davies started receiving unsolicited emails from Bentham Science Publishers, which publishes more than 200 open access journals, which turn the conventional business model of academic publishing on its head by charging publication fees to the authors of research papers and then making the content available for free. As the emails stacked up, Davis was not only encouraged to submit papers, but was also invited to serve on the editorial board of some of Bentham's journals, for which he was told he'd be allowed to publish 1 free article each year. "I received solicitations for journals for which I had no subject expertise at all," says Davis. It really painted a picture of vanity publishing. So Davis teamed up with Kent Anderson, a member of the publishing team at the New England Journal of Medicine, to put Bentham's editorial standards to the test. The pair turned to SCIGen, a program that generates nonsensical computer science papers, and submitted the resulting paper to the Open Information Science Journal, published by Bentham. The paper, entitled "Deconstructing Access Points," made no sense whatsoever, as this sample reveals. In this section, we discuss existing research into black-red trees, vacuum tubes, and courseware. On a similar note, recent work by Takahashi suggests a methodology for providing robust modulates, but does not offer an implementation. Davis and Anderson, writing under the nom de plume David Phillips and Andrew Kent, also dropped a hefty hint of the hoax by giving their institutional affiliation as a Center for Research in Applied Phrenology, or CRAP. Yet 4 months after the article was submitted, David Phillips received an email from Sana Mokarem, Bentham's assistant manager of publishing. "This is to inform you that your submitted article has been accepted for publication after peer reviewing process," name of the publication. "I would be highly grateful to you if you could please fill and sign the attached fee form and covering letter and send them back to me via email as soon as possible to avoid further delay in publication." The publication fee was $800 to be sent to a PO box in the United Arab Emirates. Having made his point, Davis withdrew the paper. I failed to mention earlier that Kevin Ryan and Frank Legg are joint editors, along with Stephen Jones, of the Journal for 9/11 Studies. So far, we have a collection of authors who appear...
I hesitate to alarm you, DPR. I just realized I do not hear you over the...
That's because
I hear myself over the feed.
That's because I've not unmuted myself. Oh, I'm so useless, aren't I?
Yeah.
Oh, dear, I apologize.
The point you just made, too, like, that's... We could just end the show on that. Like, what you just said, I had things to say, but you covered it all. Like, I can't believe 20 seconds of talking, and I just, like, man, my mind is blown. Can you repeat it?
I can't repeat it verbatim, but I'll do as best I can for those that didn't hear me. Basically, you've got to be very careful about any source and any claim that an article has been peer-reviewed. You shouldn't accept that as fact. And I'm a great fan of Potholer's view, which is that you need to check your sources to check that they're right. And, you know, the fact that something appears to have gone through a peer-reviewed process shouldn't give you total confidence that the contents are correct. I think that in relation to some publications, not the Bentham that we saw there, you can probably place high reliance on it. But it's, as I say in the video clip, it's staggering that these people, who are qualified people, sought Bentham as the place to publish evidence.
Actually,
of the greatest conspiracy ever is quite staggering.
Yeah.
I want to add another point, another example that happened to me only 2 days ago. And again, it goes back to, you know, checking the sources and verifying the sources. I was with Aaron and we were waiting to meet someone, and he was on his phone checking out the internet and the news, and he said, "You wouldn't believe this. The Pope has made this statement that the earthquake in Nepal was an act of God." And I said, "You've got to be kidding me. Surely not." And he said, no, it's right. And I said, on what justification? And he said, he scrolled down the article. I don't know where he got this information from, but he scrolled down the article and it said, apparently because they're all pagans and the Catholic Church doesn't like pagans. And we were interrupted then, and later I got back home and I thought, you know, I can't believe this. And I checked on the BBC website to look for evidence of this story, and the only items I found on the BBC website was that the Pope was leading prayer for those that were suffering and had died in the earthquake. So you've got to check your sources. Anyway, Hogtie, I've rambled on too long. You wanted to make a comment about it.
Well, this will be one of the difficulties I find with this topic, and it'll be a bit of a struggle because, like I was saying earlier, that we can kind of talk about the structure of peer review as it's as it was initially intended and as it kind of evolved through the 20th century, noting things like there were some changes that were really on purpose, like the blind review process, where you get masked identity on the manuscripts. You know, that was something that was sort of debated and discussed. No, this is probably a good idea. The problem we're going to have in discussing it is we have this sham peer review thing going on, and you know, the internet has just been such a game changer for so many different fields. Again, slightly unrelated, but I just brought to mind because I was watching a bunch of that Last Week Tonight with John Oliver, and one of the segments he did was on they call it native of advertising. And you can go on to like a newspaper, you know, who buys newspapers anymore? You go on to these online web services and, oh, here's a story. Or you go to BuzzFeed, one of the worst places for finding, you know, what an article that's actually an ad for something. And I think the increasing difficulty, I mean, there's tens of thousands of reputable journals and hundreds of thousands of crappy, you know, vanity press type journals. And, it's really difficult. I was going to say a snide thing, like it's difficult for the layman to tell the difference. Well, no, there are scientists that are getting caught up in this, because when you download the PDFs of these articles and you put one of them side by side, you can't tell that this one was, was a peer-reviewed thing with a revise, resubmit, and the person had to do revisions and get it back in and sent the proofs back and went through the whole official process. Whereas this other one, was something that they just said, oh, congratulations, you've been accepted. Send us a check for $1,500. And they're almost indistinguishable. So a lot of universities maintain lists now to help protect the professional scientists from getting caught in this thing, because you don't want to cite this other literature. If you get caught with this stuff in your references section, it shows that you're kind of off your game. So before you, like in your manuscript preparation, there'll be a central office at the university that'll give you a list of like approved journals. Like you'd search and say, well, we know this one's a good journal. We know that one's a crap journal, to help actual professional scientists who are supposed to be experts in this stuff tell the difference between a good article and a crappy article. So
could there be some, go on.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think the part of the problem we're going to have discussing here is that I can sort of discuss some of the issues about the generality of peer review. I'm just restating what I said before. But the problem is that when we start talking about how peer review presents itself to professionals and to laymen in the 21st century, like it's just a totally different game these days. Sorry, go ahead.
Do you think it would be realistic for there to be some sort of website or some sort of resource that common people who are not that up on science could go and check to see like what journals are somewhat reliable and what ones are considered crap? Or do you think that would, having something like that would kind of be problematic because I don't know, I mean, like who would they be to be the arbiter of such things?
I think I can perhaps hopefully send Hogtie in the right direction here. I believe that there is something referred to as the Impact Index. And for example, Nature has got one of the highest. Bentham doesn't, I don't think, feature greatly. Am I right, Hogtie?
I'm actually going to defer on that because, remember, so I have retired for, more than a couple of years now. So during my active publication days was sort of when this was a brewing problem with no obvious solutions. And each university would kind of handle it separately as a shield against their exposure, right? I mean, it's embarrassing to have somebody publishing with your university name have a pull one of these bad articles. So they would kind of do it on their own, out of their own self-interest. I think you're on the right track when you say, like, what would be a neat idea? Pardon me. It'd be a neat idea to have this, but who's going to be the arbiter of it? Like, we're going to have a ministry of truth now to make the obvious Orwellian reference.
Yeah.
And on my retirement, there actually still was not a centralized service for that. But I've heard from people that, yeah, there are good services. I know that even going through like citation index is a good way to know, like, are other people referring to this paper? But that doesn't work for new papers. Right, because it may have not been well circulated yet. But I do think that one of the things to distinguish between the journals, I mean, it's almost like, how spam filters work, right? There'll be websites that are just known, like once people realize, hey, this is obviously just spamming, there'll be your ad blocker, things like that. There's like this registry of like real dud things. I think that one distinction we have to make from one journal to another is the process behind it. And one thing I do, like the way I used to kind of get around this problem was when I read something or if somebody, I shouldn't say I used to do this. I still do this today because I will have creationists or anti-vaxxers or whoever send me a link to an article or give me the name of some researchers or something and say, well, they published this. So I'll go and I'll find that article and it'll be in the journal of I don't know what because I've never seen this journal before. I then go to that journal's main page and I go to the instructions to authors. Every journal has a thing that says that tells you like how to submit your manuscripts and get it published. So just as a comparison, I loaded up the NEJM, I think the very famous New England Journal of Medicine. Most people know about this. And that's a longstanding, incredible journal. If you go to their instructions for authors, it tells you, how to do this stuff, what you're sending and that sort of thing. Whereas if you go to some of the others like Bentham or whatever, it gives you a price table on how much it costs to get your stuff submitted. So, I mean, I think a central registry would make that a lot easier. I'm just sort of borrowing from my experience on this that the way I would distinguish what's good and bad is whether or not they were following the traditional process in manuscript review, which is stated expressly on their instructions to authors. And or whether they were, here's how much it costs to do it. And I think that if we're going to have some sort of central registry, I'm sure that there is one that exists already. I would hope that it's done by not just sort of people's assessments of it, but actually, are they following the process? It'd certainly be a lot easier to have that than having people do it on a journal by journal basis.
The fact is, though, let's face it, that on all issues, I can't remember ever sort of like thinking, oh, I really need to get to the bottom of this. Let me go and read a peer-reviewed paper. We rely on other sources, and the internet is a great source for information, but it's also potentially a source for misinformation. Now, you mentioned earlier, Hogtie, the issue of vaccinations. I have to say that I think I know what my position is, but if I was asked to justify it, I wouldn't be able to do so, because I would have to claim reliance upon opinions of other people who I do trust, and maybe that trust is justified, maybe it's not. But when we're seeking truth, we do not go to peer-reviewed papers, and if we did, we probably wouldn't understand them. So we have to rely on a sort of like a secondary source, don't we?
Yeah, well, I'll save that first, because that's one thing I do find funny as, you know, the Google Plus and Hangouts community and stuff is really growing. You do get a lot more of this, like people sending links and being like, well, this proves that. Or the weird thing lately is the demand from creationists. Well, you send me a paper that proves that a dog gives birth to a cat or whatever. I think we have to remember incredibly how small and bite-sized a research paper is. I mean, when you think about how hard it is to read a single research paper, and how little you actually learn. Like reading a single research paper, does it actually change your epistemic position? Are you now more of an expert on a topic because you read a single research paper? The increment that you understand a topic better having read a research paper is pretty trivial. The reason that those papers are there, and I'm going to say this, and it's going to really lend itself to the elitist ivory tower mindset that I think a lot of anti-science people accuse scientists of having. But those peer-reviewed journals are to be read, are intended to be read by peers who are writing on the topic, right? It's kind of the lattice work of communication from scientist to scientist, right? It's not meant for public dissemination. And nobody has a problem with people in the public reading them. But the reason they're there, they're these sort of little bite-sized pieces to building up expertise in a particular sub-sub-sub-field of an area in science. And what's understood to happen or intended to happen when somebody writes a peer-reviewed paper is that the next person who's doing research in that area will do a general survey of 50 to 100 of these other papers and sort of see, okay, where's the next step in this lattice work? So whenever I hear a creationist say, well, give me a paper that proves that. Well, you know what? There is no, they'll make this claim. There is no paper that proves evolution true. Well, guess what? There is no paper that proves evolution true. There is no paper that proves that the sun is hot, right? Like it's each paper is like a little bit of the lattice work towards building your way to some particular bit of knowledge in a sub field. So like I say, the amount of effort it takes to sort of read and look up things in an individual, even like a little three-page empirical report, I don't think it's actually the way that laymen ought to learn. If you really wanted to be an expert in something, then I'm not saying don't read peer-reviewed journals, but don't read one article and think, hey, I've now learned something, so I'm smarter than Nephilim Free, right? Like you do the actual literature review and pull all 50 or all 80 or all 150 papers and read all of those. That's the way scientists actually learn.
Vadim, let's go back to you.
Sure. I guess I'd like to, just because, I think I understand where you stand, but let me give a hypothetical. Based again on the 9/11 bullcrap. A common claim is that World Trade Center 7 fell at free fall speed. And therefore, just because of that, that is clear proof that there was a controlled demolition. Now, I've encountered that argument from several 9/11 truthers, and many times I've said, like, well, if that's true, it should be pretty simple for them to prove that within a peer review paper. Why is there no peer review paper, kind of establishing this pretty simple thing? Now, do you think that that is a poor or a decent, kind of way to respond?
I don't think it's a particularly good way to respond. The measurements of the speed at which it collapsed is
not. Can you repeat that? I lost you for 1 second. Can you repeat that?
Yeah, sure. I don't think it's a particularly good way to respond. I think yeah. The speed at which it collapsed is not really going to be the subject matter of a peer-reviewed paper. It's a subject of empirical evidence which you can get from video sources and the like. And I actually, again, sorry to blow my own trumpet, I made a video about the collapse of World Trade Center 7. And it didn't. There may be parts of it that did, but that's utterly understandable. And yeah, there was a huge paper and done on it. I can't remember which particular organization did it now, and I apologize
NIST.
For that. NIST.
Yeah. NIST.
Yeah, and even they accept that parts of it did, and there were problems with that and the criticisms of it. But I've to be honest, I've not really looked into it, partly because I've not been asked to, and partly because I can't be bothered to. It's a huge document, and I'm not going to go through every single detail just because one conspiracy theorist thinks that there's some fault in it. If he identifies, or he or she identifies at any particular point, then I might. But I'm not inclined to do it otherwise. But I think there's sufficient evidence on it, and what would a peer review paper bring to the table? I don't know. Hogtie.
Yeah, that's my concern as well. Is it sort of, what is the peer review process for? And it really, as I say, it's building this lattice work of more sort of theoretical knowledge about some some area in science. Of course, there are applied. There's engineering journals that talk about applications and new materials developments and whatnot, but these things tend to be very I'm just find the right word for this distinction I'm drawing here. They tend to be kind of concepts focused or theoretical focused, or what are we learning here? I want to contrast that with the analysis of a single event in history, right, which tends to not be the domain of scientists or even engineers, where we need to make some sort of adjudication about whether or not something happened. Like, did I know how to say this, did O.J. Simpson actually kill two people back in the 90s? While there were scientists who contributed to the process of divining his innocence or guilt, they weren't doing it through the mechanism of peer-reviewed media, right? There's a completely different form for discussing the truth about claims, the truth of claims from historical events. So this happened one night in the 90s where these two people were dead, and we said, well, some people say OJ did it. So we do involve scientists in the process, but they contribute to a process that's a matter of public trial through the courts. And there aren't scientists who are saying, well, this is going to contribute to the body of knowledge of humanity, so I need to write a peer-reviewed paper about this. And I think the same thing happens with like airplane disasters, for example, where when we try to figure out, well, why did this, any transportation disaster, why did this train go off the rails? Why did this plane crash? There's investigations and there's hearings and there are commissions, but it generally doesn't lend itself to peer-reviewed literature unless down the road there's some process or change or innovation that would make it, to sort of add to the under the overall understanding of general principles that would tend to make transportation more safe, then that might be discussed in the peer-reviewed literature. But as far as the adjudication about a single incident, like why did this particular plane crash, you know, we have trials of the court system, we have commissions and tribunals and all these other administrative bodies that tend to deal with that wholly apart from what goes on in the peer-reviewed literature. So it's that kind of thing, like when people hold it up and say, well, if this were true, then why aren't there any peer-reviewed articles about it? I don't know if you think OJ killed anybody, but I don't think there are any peer-reviewed articles. Like there's no, you know, nobody made a journal submission. You can't go to the, you know, journal of whatever and find some scientists who agreed that OJ actually killed a couple of people.
Just before we come back, Vadim, I'm pretty certain that in one of the videos I made about 9/11, I did actually refer to one paper, which I believe was peer-reviewed, and it was a calculation of how fast the Twin Towers should have fallen, given the correct scenario of a plane hitting them without any sort of like explosives or whatever. So contrary to what I said and what Hogtie's just said, in that particular case, there was a peer-reviewed paper that did actually address that issue. But I'll include a link to it if people are interested.
Sure. I would like to see it. I probably have seen it at some point because I'm kind of a little bit of a 9/11 conspiracy nerd. But of course, I think all that stuff is crap. But I guess I've already... just feel like I have to throw that out there. I don't want anyone to confuse me. What?
No, I really enjoy 9/11. I've not looked into it for maybe 3 or 4 years or more now. When you were looking into it, which bits of evidence did you find most persuasive for there being a conspiracy?
For there being a conspiracy? I think that the only plausible or close to plausible, I don't think it's actually plausible if you really analyze it, but I think that if you're going to make an argument that 9/11 was an inside job, I think it has to be more, I'm not sure if you're familiar with these terms, lie hop rather than my hop. Lie hop is let it happen on purpose, whereas my hop is made it happen on purpose. And lie hop is more the Bush administration and perhaps some others knew that this was about to happen, but just really didn't do anything to stop it, and kind of thought it would be a good opportunity to exploit in the long run, so didn't do anything about it. And then my hop is the whole can be anything from, you know, planting bombs in World Trade Center 7 and 1 and 2 to, you know, the fake planes. I don't know how aware you are of all the wacky, theories there are. There are actually people who think that the planes, that there were no planes, that they were actually holograms, and it was more or less a death ray from space that took down the towers.
The most extraordinary one that I recall, and the details, I apologize for not having them to hand.
Sure.
But I think it was the fourth plane that crashed before it hit mm-hmm. its intended target. And the allegation by the conspiracy theorists is it actually landed at Cleveland Hopkins Airport, and the passengers were taken away.
What do you do with them?
Yeah. You know, what's happened to them, no one knows, but presumably they're kept in captivity and they can't communicate and let their story be known or whatever. There are some pretty crazy theories.
Oh, there's all sorts of insane theories. I think they're pretty fascinating. But, I'd say in a superficial way, if you don't really do much investigation, then perhaps the thermite paper that you are discussing in your video is some of the best evidence. I mean, it's crappy evidence. It's awful.
It's not evidence.
But I'm just, I'm just saying that, like, no, you're totally correct. But I'm just saying, to someone who is just glancing over all of the, you know, just the claims that are made by these wackos, you know, just hearing like, you know, several scientists discovered this thermite stuff. And, you know, and if you don't know, one, how shady the Bentham Journal was, if you don't know kind of really how thermite works, I mean, thermite would be an awful thing to use for such an endeavor. You know, if you don't know the, but just if all you hear is this stuff was found and these scientists, and you know, you just assume that the scientists are just on the level and whatnot, then I think that is also, you know, like a pretty good in terms of, you know, kind of getting people onto that side of things. And then I guess the last thing that, maybe I'd also, say is just a lot of people, because I actually haven't been doing it so much these days, but for a while I was actually like, you know, kind of like looking often in the comments of these videos and whatnot at what these people, 9/11 truthers, had to say. Probably another one of the most common things that they'll bring up is just the fact that they have 2,000 engineers and architects that, you know, that are behind all this. And when you really think about it, you know, 2,000 is like a drop in the bucket in terms of all the engineers and architects that are out there in the world. And then if you even go further and you look at the credentials of these people, they're lousy. You know, they really, a lot of them are jokes. There's barely a real structural engineer out of all of them. And a lot of these supposed structural engineers don't even have real licenses, or they got their, you know, their what type of degree do you have if you're an engineer? You know, they got whatever their degree is from diploma bills and stuff.
So. I know I got what letters I get, because I did actually do mechanical engineering as my first degree. I think, and this again is a problem, isn't it? That and I may well be as guilty as anyone else, but we seek sources that verify our beliefs and the positions that we want to hold in the same way that they do. By they, I mean, in this particular case, the 9/11 conspiracy theorists. So should we be too judgmental that they cling on to these things? I guess perhaps not, but we ought to challenge them on their beliefs.
I think we can be judgmental. I mean, I don't think we can be too judgmental of them if we, you know, if they have a very superficial understanding. But there are many who kind of, you know, will not be receptive when you put forth a good argument, when you kind of establish why they shouldn't put much, you know, why they shouldn't believe that. I think at that point you can judge them. Maybe I'm being too harsh a critic. I don't know. What do you think, Hogtie?
Oh, I was with you till about the last 20 seconds there. I was actually, there was a photo I was looking for, so I apologize. I was briefly distracted there.
Okay.
Sure. Just to repeat the last sentence, what you said there.
I just said that. Go for it.
No, sorry, I was trying to repeat your last few sentences or seconds, and yes. Then I realized it was incredibly presumptuous of me to do so, and I should allow you to do
so. No, well, I'd actually prefer that you do, because I need to, I'll be back in 30 seconds, okay? Sorry about that.
Well, now I've forgotten what they were, so now we're in an impossible
Okay, plan. Okay, well, unfortunately, I won't be able to hear your response, but what I was saying is basically... I do think it's okay to, in most circumstances, if people have been kind of led to the like decent arguments that kind of tear their claims to shreds, and they aren't receptive to them, then at that point, I think it's okay to judge them somewhat. Maybe I'm too harsh a critic, but I...
Oh, we're frozen.
Now he's frozen.
I think...
Now he's gone.
Oh, he just disappeared. That was like a magic trick. That was... No, I think I take his point. I had caught the earlier part about what sort of got him initially into the 9/11 thing, you know, even only briefly. And I know, like I'll admit, I had a weekend where I was pretty sure about it myself. But then I apologize, and I kind of tuned out a bit as I was looking for this photo about kind of, I don't say judging other people, but judging their ability to divine the truth. So let me touch on those two topics, and maybe he'll come back for the second one. I'll say the thing that got me a little bit perturbed about 9/11, that one awful weekend, I sat there watching YouTube videos. I may have seen Loose Change. I may have been one of the cuts I'd seen of it that sort of got me. The thermite thing, I think, was the jaw-dropping moment for me when they showed the clips of like this dripping steel, and I was like, oh, of course it's thermite, of course. And I didn't stay convinced of it for very long. And I want to say it's because I was lucky to have a, sort of a formative experience with bad information. So when I was sort of a preteen, I don't know, maybe 12, 13 in that range, and I was at that age where just like, oh, this stuff is so cool. There's UFOs and there's ghosts and whatever. I learned about spontaneous human combustion. And I thought, man, this is a spontaneous human combustion. I'm going to wait till he gets his earbuds back in. So he's like, did we change topics? As I was saying about spontaneous human combustion.
My favorite.
Oh, yeah. When I was an early teen, I was quite fascinated by it. And, of course, there's no internet, right? You actually go to the library. And I remember even doing a little report for school about it. And I had to take the book and then photocopy this photo out of this book. And then glue it onto my little typed report and then photocopy that so it all looked like one page. There was a fairly famous story. I was actually looking, that's what distracted me. I was looking for the name of this doctor. There was a doctor that actually had died in his bathroom, burst into flames in his bathroom. And as is common with these spontaneous human combustion stories, there's no source of ignition around and the lower legs remain, right? So the torso will burn away. The lower legs remain. If there's something plastic on the counter, it'll melt, but glass and steel sit there and it's all fine. Even wood won't burn. I mean, it's the craziest thing, unless it's right underneath them. People burn through the floorboards and that sort of thing. So they find this guy's remnants of this bathrobe and his lower legs and a slipper. And the rest of the stuff's all burnt up in his bathroom. And of course, there's no source of ignition. And I was fascinated by this story and many others. But this was, I remember this is a very formative experience because not too long after that, I was looking at another source, like doing some research about spontaneous human combustion. And they showed the same photo. Remember, this isn't the internet where people are sitting there like cropping photos with like Photoshop or whatever. The same photo, but it was the full photo that was taken of the scene. And you could see the remnants of the robe draped around a space heater. And in the write-up for the story, they described that this doctor was fairly old and had been advised by his doctors that he needed to quit smoking because he had severe heart problems. And the obvious story was he was in the bathroom, got up from the toilet, and had a stroke or a heart attack or something, fell down on the space heater. That was the source of ignition. So anyway, the reason why I say this, et cetera, et cetera. The reason why I say this was a formative experience was because I found all these wonderful stories about spontaneous human combustion. And even though nobody understood it, I found this one story that when you actually looked at another source that showed the whole photo, instead of carefully cropping out the space heater, and then included the line in the story, there were no sources of ignition around. It turns out that, like, well, why did this other thing use less information and then add in a fact that's demonstrably not true? And it just made me start to question, like, well, what about these other stories? And there's the famous woman of this famous story of the woman that sent her daughter down to go get some more cigarettes for her granddaughter down to go get some more cigarettes for her. And the daughter came back like 5 minutes later from the corner store and the whole apartment was burnt down and her grandmother was burnt. And it turns out, no, she sent her the kid left the house and was gone for 3 days. And when she got back, her grandmother was dead. And the TV had all melted, except for the glass part was still okay. Like every time and it just went on and on like that. Every one of these stories that I had of spontaneous human combustion, as soon as you found another source for it, They gave you the actual full story, and nobody is ever baffled by them. It's like that Tim Minchin. Tim Minchin does this 9-minute beat poem called Storm. You got to seek this thing out. It's so good. But in there, he says,
"Yeah,
like,
I've seen it.
It's so good." Like when he makes the point about how it's like awesome. Scooby-Doo. Yeah, like Scooby-Doo, right? Like the great thing about Scooby-Doo is that the mysteries are solved, and no mystery has ever been solved revealed to be magic, right? It's always something. And when you look at any of these stories, it always turns out that the underlying facts, the people who were there weren't at all baffled or confused. They went, well, this is what happened. It's after the story starts running wild, and then people collect little bits and pieces of these stories and assemble a book based on fragments of these stories that they start to believe something different. So let me try to bring in this observation now to your earlier point. I'll bring it in for a landing here, because you'd said about sort of, judging people, but sort of when you're talking to somebody and he gives you some information, and you're wondering, do I trust this person? Ought I take their word for it? And then you realize that he's an idiot. You know, like you sort of naturally come to that assessment, but there's a rational grounds to make that assessment. And I'm going to give you an example. And anybody who's been watching the Hangouts that have been on my channel are going to be frustrated by this, because this will be or entertained, one of the two, because this will be like the fifth time I brought it up in 2 weeks. But a couple weeks ago, I was watching a Hangout. I saw a guy make this comment that about Kent Hovind. He says, even the IRS admitted that Kent Hovind didn't break any laws. So why is he still in jail? Why are they putting him on trial again? And I'd left a comment on the guy's video who'd had this video clip. I said, of this other guy who we always know is full of shit. So I put on there, interesting. Even though the IRS admitted that Kent Hovind didn't break any laws, he's still in jail and they want to put him in jail again. And I quoted that. Even the IRS admitted he didn't break any laws. Well, I would love to see that quotation. Like, where does that come from? Who from the IRS says this? And so this guy, this creationist, ends up putting up this link that says, well, here you go. And his source was a letter to the editor that some woman from Garland, Texas, wrote to some online nutter newspaper based on something she had read at the news service usnews.com, based on their retelling of a news story that AP had put out based on sworn testimony of the IRS commissioner before the Congressional Ways and Means Committee on February 11th of 2015. So I went, blah, 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 Ways and Means Committee, February 11th, 2015. And I downloaded that document and found out what the IRS commissioner actually said to the Ways and Means Committee. And of course, he did not apologize to Kent Hovind or say that Kent Hovind didn't commit any crimes. So I post this back to him and he goes like, oh, I knew you'd find something wrong with my source. I'm sorry, your source is letter to the editor from Sally Housecoat in Garland, Texas. Like, so yes, it is. I guess now that I talk through that, I say it's perfectly acceptable to be judgmental of other people who is very clear that they don't have a truth filtering process. They have a fantasy embracing process. They've got this nut bar fantasy about the moon landing hoax or 9/11 or creationism or whatever, and it's like this sticky strip of flypaper that other stupid ideas just stick onto, and yet somehow it repels actual information and knowledge. Was that a delightful recounting of?
Absolutely.
I occasionally rant. Absolutely. I occasionally rant, but this was.
I love it when, that's just such a typical trick of just people who, people who are into conspiracy theories and people who, are trying to pull some sort of hoax, just kind of throwing out facts without kind of just giving you the whole story. Just 9/11 things are springing to mind so much. There's one story that you'll typically hear, which is that the truthers, it tries to legitimize the idea that the planes should have been intercepted, and they talk about this this golfer named, I think his name was Payne Stewart. I think he had the last name of Stewart. Maybe I'm forgetting his first name. But basically, he was supposedly intercepted like a few years before 9/11 when his private plane was flying in like a the incorrect zone or something. Supposedly he was intercepted within 15 minutes. But what they don't tell you is that it was actually an hour and 15 minutes, and his plane was, and the planes that intercepted him were flying across time zones. So it took an hour and 15 minutes rather, you know, and people just, you know, they're kind of telling the truth because they're kind of giving you, like, you know, the sliver that they're giving you is technically correct, but then there's like this other thing that, like, you know, once you know that big piece of information, it just totally renders like, you know, BS. So
that's funny.
Yeah.
Although I wonder what happens though the next day if you say, well, hey, look, I looked into it. It turns out that this thing says, you know, they took off at 6:01 p.m. and they intercepted him by 6:16 p.m. You know, but central versus eastern. So guess what? Mm-hmm. Or maybe I got it backwards. Whatever. What happens the next day? Because I just did a hangout last night where I was talking to somebody again that the Hovind thing had come up, and so Hovind was convicted on tax evasion and structuring transactions and one count of obstruction of justice. This is going back to 2006. And then afterwards, people were like, what is this structuring thing? So then there got this whole discussion about, oh, so structuring is basically taking money out of your bank account. Well, that doesn't make sense. That's illegal. And the creationists, the Hovindicators, as they now like to call themselves, have started to say, well, that's crazy that he got convicted for taking money out of the bank, this structuring thing. And then somehow they forgot he was convicted of tax evasion. And then now, in 2015, the story is, do you realize he wasn't even convicted of tax evasion? They convicted him of this structuring. It's just taking money at your bank. People say he was convicted of tax evasion, but he wasn't. It was just tax evasion. So anyway, aware of this, I have a copy of the transcript from the sentencing hearing and the reasons for judgment for sentencing. And I'm talking with this Hovindicator on my channel last night, and I say, well, was Hovind convicted of tax evasion? And he goes, no, not tax evasion. He was convicted of structuring, which just means taking money out of your bank account. I said, yeah, but I want to know about the tax evasion. Did they indict him for tax evasion? Was he even charged for tax evasion? Nope, wasn't even part of the indictment. Well, that's really funny. And I load up my screen share and I say, well, here's a copy of the indictment. Here, you know, screen share the indictment and the sorry, it was the sentencing thing, but I've got the indictment on here. I didn't screen share it. I told him, I said, well, what if I tell you, I've got the indictment here in my hard drive. And it says, and I can do this from memory, 12 counts of tax evasion, 45 counts of structuring transactions, and one count of obstructing justice. And he's like, well, according to who? I said, well, according to the indictment. Like, you can download these things right from the court. And then, and he said, well, you're looking at it from your atheist point of view. So I screen share. I say, no, I'm looking at it from the point of view of looking at the court documents, and I'm screen sharing the documents. I got so mad at the guy for just going, well, that's your perspective, blah, 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 that when I went to hit stop screen share, I accidentally hit stop broadcast, and I actually ended the hangout by accident by hitting the wrong button. But anyway, we ended up getting back into it and talking about some other stuff. And then later in the broadcast, when we're about to wrap up, hey, good chat, whatever, they're talking about presuppositionalism or whatever, yes, I say, well, let me ask you something before we leave. I just have one question for you. Was Kent Hovind convicted of tax evasion? And he says, I don't really know. I'm not really following the trial. The 2006 trial, he's not following, even though I just screen shared the reasons for judgment at sentencing. Like, don't know. Sorry, I believe your sound is
I mean,
dry.
Like, my sound is bad? You can't hear me?
No, we just lost you for about 3 seconds. So start again. You're good.
Okay. Okay, when it comes to the Hovindicators, what the goddamn frickin' fuck is like the kind of the reasoning behind why he was put in jail? I mean, are they saying that, like, that the reason is that he, like, you know, just plays the, you know, the evolutionary model. I mean, the, you know, the theory of evolution, and that, I mean, what is the reason? Why would they want to jail him? Like, just go. What do you guys think? Like, who would be behind that? And why only him? Why are there not all these other people like, you know, Ken Ham and others who have not been jailed, who essentially do the same thing?
Do you want to go DPR? I thought I saw you unmute. Oh, you're just entertained. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. It's a great question. I would do, but
because I've been away for a while, my gogs seem to be sort of like more affectionate than normal. So that
they're worried.
Both of them jump up on the desk in the last few moments.
You're worried you got lost.
And my mouse got lost underneath one of the gogs.
Oh, okay.
So I couldn't unmute myself. But you go first. I mean,
oh, if you. Oh.
I don't know. Okay, I'll go first.
I don't know what
these people are thinking. I have spent a lot of time trying to understand their mental processes. And obviously, I approach it from an arrogant point of view, which is that I think that I have got good abilities to reason and to understand and whatever. And. I don't get where they're coming from in the same way as I don't get, not only we're talking now about people who think that Kent shouldn't have been convicted, but also more generally, creationists. I simply don't understand how their minds work. I also would extend it further and say, I don't understand how people who are religious, how their minds work. I approach it from my point of view, and I think that they have no basis for genuinely holding the views that they do. But I'm not them, and it may be that I'm extraordinarily arrogant. Maybe it is that they have some greater insight, some greater knowledge than I have. But if that is the case, they have never been able to express it. Sorry, God, off you go.
I mean,
they've not been able to express it to me in a way that is it makes sense or that is verifiable. So, you know, I really don't know. I wish I did. I wish I could understand the minds of the conspiracists and also the religious and all sorts of other people who don't share my views, because obviously. I have an arrogant view that my views are justifiable, but they would probably say that the same to me, that their views are justifiable.
I think that ultimately the reasoning is in their minds that they're basically. They think that the entire scientific world is in cahoots to kind of perpetuate this hoax, right? And so I think that their reasoning is that you know, the scientific establishment wants to you know, kind of keep people from believing in God and whatnot, and so. By like having the evolutionary theory out there, it kind of it disproves God in some people's eyes. I mean, I think that that's what it's about.
I'll go a little bit further. I'm prepared to make, for the sake of argument, because I haven't fully thought it through, but I'm prepared to say that I don't think that these people actually believe what they're saying. The reason is because I think that they, in most regards, most people I talk to, whether they're creationists or Christians or whatever, most people are perfectly able to analyze in the same way pretty much all the information that I would. They can cross the road in the same way that I do. They know when traffic's coming one way or the other. They know which way to look. They know where to go if they're that's not a good example. They know where to take their car if their car is whatever. They function in exactly the same way during everyday life as I do, but there is one part of their existence which is totally contrary to mine, and that is that they have some belief in some sort of divinity, which quite often they almost always they were in disagreement as to the exact nature of that divinity amongst themselves. But they're happy to hold on to that belief. And I suspect it's because they have been indoctrinated into it. They have been fear has been instilled in them that if they give up this belief, they doubt the existence of God, then they're in serious shit. And even I, who had very mild indoctrination between the ages of perhaps 4 and 8, that sort of stage in my upbringing, even I remember being told that doubting God was a dreadful thing to do. You must never do that. And so even though, as I say, it was a mild indoctrination, that was a hurdle to overcome before I became an atheist at the age of, I don't know, 9, 11, or something, very early on. But that was a hurdle. And I think that it's still a hurdle for a lot of people because they've been indoctrinated in a far greater way than I have. And their fear of consequences, of doubting, to doubt itself is a sin. I mean, what an extraordinary, ridiculous message that is. But that's the message that they're given. And then that is enforced by the concept of hell, which of course is not mentioned in the Bible at all, unless you read a particular or take a particular reading of some passages, the Book of Revelation being one of them. But it really isn't mentioned. Hell is a concept that was man-made, as most gods are and most religions are, well, all, to reinforce belief. So I'm sorry, I'm rambling now. And I'm not entirely sure I've addressed the question, and I can't remember what the question was, but occasionally I do like to rant, so my apologies for that.
Well, no, I think problem. The initial question was about what are those guys thinking when the whole vindicators, when they say,
yeah, I'm
like,
totally
how,
sorry, yes.
How do they go?
What are they thinking? And my answer, back to what I said, I don't know. I just simply, however much I try, I can't get inside their minds and think the way that they're thinking.
Yeah. Well, I did, and then of course that topic, that question takes us to the thing about, the basic, how do they think? Are they actually thinking differently than us? I know there's a YouTube user now, Dave, Dave S., who I've had some interactions with lately because of some disagreements with a couple of creationists on YouTube and some unpleasantness around blocking and personal insults and stuff. But this Dave S. guy is quite a nice fellow. And he's in post-secondary in psychology at some level. I don't recall off the top of my head if it's undergraduate or master's, but he's it's certainly a passion for him. And he takes a position that there are people who think very differently. And I think this is something we should explore because we sort of touch on this object once in a while. But how do creationists think? How do, when we call people nutters, like what is their belief forming process? Like what do they rely on as justification? And then we get into the same question quite often about, oh, well, I don't really think they actually believe that. You know, when somebody says something, no, I really believe in God. And then somebody will point out, well, I don't think they actually really believe that because look at the way they're acting. You know, and I struggle with that. I think that at a fundamental level, the very notion of what it means to believe a proposition, when I say, I believe this, it's actually different between us and them. And I think that actually would be worth a whole segment if we have somebody who's certainly more of an expert than any of us on the psychology of beliefs and belief formation. But to go back to the Hoven thing and what are they actually pitching? Like at least when you talk to a moon conspiracy, moon landing hoax person or a 9/11 person, they'll be able to tell you the story about what the conspiracy is. I heard it myself from the guy last night I was talking to, who said straight out that Hoven rubbed the federal government the wrong way. And he's not just talking about the federal government, because remember, this is part of a larger overarching governing conspiracy. And when he never did pin it down whether he's talking about the New World Order or the Illuminati or the Trilateral Commission or certainly something anti-Christian. So in their view, and this is not a Christian thing, this is not biblical, this is the radical evangelical take on the Book of Revelation. And that is that there's a supernatural or spiritual principality that sort of is a shadowy governing world. And they go after people. They take down the ones who might be saving souls. So they're going after Kent Hovind because he's been there exposing this conspiracy. And they generally go after Christians. And as proof of this, I had to laugh because at one point he says, well, look at all these other people that owe tax. Like, why are they not in jail? Like, for example, Al Sharpton. Why don't they go after Al Sharpton? Because he owes money. Why is that guy out walking around free? And I said, I don't know, because the Reverend Al Sharpton is an atheist? Is that why he's free on the streets? Like, to answer your question, as far as I know, they're saying it's because the IRS is part of the federal government, is part of the New World Order, Illuminati, Antichrist, whatever. They do connect the prosecution / persecution of Kent Hovind spiritual conspiracy. Throw in one more point of proof of that, because they will also point out to you that, remember, all the people who are involved in the prosecution at Kent Hovind are sinful people, unrepentant sinners, right? So, for example, they will tell you that the main prosecutor is this man who was caught after Hovind was put in jail. This guy was caught. His name is John Roy Atchison. He was caught in a pedophile sting type operation where he was attempting to solicit, believe it or not, a 5-year-old for a sexual encounter in, I think, Michigan. I don't remember, but he got caught. He was put in jail and he committed suicide while in jail. So while his guilt's never been determined in a court of law, pretty obvious he's guilty. And they'll point out that while the judge was part of some illegal porn ring, I don't know specifically what that was about, and the you know. But anyway, I heard this thing about this prosecutor who was this man who was a pedophile, and I kept thinking, well, that's really weird because the prosecutor in his case is a woman named Michelle Heldmeier, something like that. So who is this? So I go and I chase down the story. It turns out that yes, there was one guy, that John Roy Atchison. He was an assistant attorney who did a couple days worth of part of the investigation. You know, he one of the documents he submitted was a request for a warrant or something. And then the next document he submitted was a cancellation of the first document. And then he was assigned to other cases. He was an incredibly minor player in the investigation, and he was absolutely not involved in the prosecution. And yet they refer – what you'll hear from these guys is they'll say the prosecutor in the Hovind case was this guy who was a pedophile who later killed himself when he was caught. And what was my point here? Because it's all part of this. And then the stories about the judge being part of some illegal porn ring, not true. They just made that up outright. So that's why it's all part of this package of, like, there's this spiritual, demonic, antichrist, whatever force that kind of runs the world. And there are human beings that have authority and power in the world. And, you know, we go along with it because we love our sin. And that's why Hovind's in jail. And they will discuss that to death. If you actually want to talk about, well, here's a list of 45 transactions that are $9,500, $9,600, $9,500. They're like, meh, whatever. They don't want to talk about the actual facts. They want to talk about the sins of the people who they believe were involved in the prosecution, whether they were involved in the prosecution or not. So it's just another sticky flypaper example. They just love ideas that they already agree with.
Okay, everything else. You've had a rant from me and a rant from.
it's the rant episode.
Go for it. You've got a rant building up in you.
I don't know. I don't think that this is a rant. We'll see. Perhaps it will be. I'm just going to jump back just a little to something that I think both of you mentioned, which is the idea that. Conspiracy theorists and religious zealots think differently than us. I think that's definitely possible. That makes a lot of sense to me. But at the same time, one thing that I think is really fascinating is that I have seen instances where, and again, I'm going to use a 9/11 example, where when these people want to, have something that is bunk that they want to debunk, they're capable of doing it. And one example is, you know, there's Dr. Judy Wood, who is the kind of mastermind of the theory that that this Tesla-like device from space was used to take down the towers. That's the sort of like, like space laser theory, although she has a problem with it. You know, she doesn't put it in that terminology. And then there's, you know, the more conventional people who believe that, like, you know, thermite or explosives were used to take down the towers. And both of these sides have actually, if you look on their websites, both of these sides have put forth pretty well reasoned debunkings of each other. You know, like but both of them believe that the other one is incorrect. And so, like, if you look at their debunkings, they're pretty solid. That's not just my opinion. Like, I go on like the Randy boards and Metabunk, and, you know, a lot of people who I think have more of an expertise in this sort of thing agree with that. So I just think that's really interesting that, like, when it comes to issues that they don't believe, that they are able to put on kind of a more skeptical hat, if you will, and apply, like, you know, a real, like, you know, just the scientific method to debunking things. What do you guys think of that?
It's very interesting. And indeed, the reason I got into doing 9/11 videos was because I made a correlation in an earlier video about creationists and conspiracy theorists. And I said that perhaps there's something that sort of like is common in their way of thinking, their ability to sort of like deal with evidence and whatever. And it came out of that first video that then, because of criticisms I had about the comments I made about 9/11 conspiracists, that's when I did my 9/11 series of videos. I think it's very interesting, and again, it actually draws back to a parallel, you know, between different denominations of Christians, and there are supposed to be, what, 30,000 different denominations. I'm not entirely sure that figure is accurate, but it doesn't matter. There are sufficient, even if it's not 30,000, to show that even though all these people believe in the same God, they can't actually decide amongst themselves exactly what God this is, or what his nature is, or what he wants, more specifically. And I suspect it's because pretty much everyone has everyone who believes has an individual idea about what their God wants, and of course their God is exactly compatible with what they want. If you hear some sort of Christians talk about this when they talk about moving from one particular denomination to another, it really sounds as if they're window shopping. They're finding a God that fits them. Well, I wonder why that is. Sorry, I'm trying not to talk too much in these shows, and
reminds me of just real quickly. That actually reminds me of Glenn Beck. One time, I heard Glenn Beck talking about his belief in the Mormon religion, and he kind of started it off by saying, like, you know, there came a time when Bessie and I'm just, I don't, that's not his wife's name, but, you know, he was referring to his wife. And he basically said, like, there was a time where Bessie and I just realized we needed some faith in our lives, and we just kind of looked into all the options, and Mormonism seemed like the one, you know. So again, it's like the same thing where it's like you weren't really drawn to this. It's just like you thought, like, okay, it's like getting a car. Okay, I gotta get something. Let's see which one looks nice to me. I'm sorry, Hogtie, were you gonna say something?
Yeah, that's the whole view that looks nice to me. I was going to say something too about when you're discussing these things with people, something DPR just said kind of reminded me about when you know you're talking to a crazy person who's just not interested in the truth. One thing I remember about that time when DPR put those videos up was that, you know, we were all at the time kind of making our little anti, you know, making fun of creationism and that sort of thing. We're doing our little videos, and you'd always get a couple of cranky creationists complain at you and whatnot. And you might occasionally get a private message that was calling you down or whatnot, but usually it was just sort of comments, right? Or they'd do a response video and they'd tell you what an idiot you are. And it was sort of a manageable stream of banter between the two sides at that time, at least, back when you could attach video responses to videos. But if I recall correctly, overnight, DPR's channel was just like this, like greatest insult, like the 9/11 truthers responded just absolutely fiery. They just went loony over it. And I think he got more of a response from his Let's Discuss 9/11 videos than the previous 10 or 20 creationist videos. And we're all a little surprised by that because we sort of did not recognize what an untapped thing this is. And I found this recently too. Like, I've been doing this for a while, and then only this last year, around the time that the Ebola story started to strike, I got into this anti-vax thing. So let's start talking to some of these people, and they're unmanageable. Like, they're loony. You cannot have a normal conversation with them. And, you know, so I do this show and I do some hangouts and whatnot and comment exchanges and that sort of thing. And I really notice a difference in the way that people react. We have a difference of opinion, right? So we're going to, you know, lock horns, butt heads, whatever the term is. And we just disagree about this. And we're going to get to the point where we're going to express our frustrations because I'm right and you're wrong, right? And in your mind, you're right, I'm wrong, whatever. It tends to be that the skeptics, rational thinkers, whatever, that sort of thing, will get upset and start saying, well, again, look at this evidence. Look, here's more evidence. Here's more evidence. I was just moments ago telling the story about how I was actually getting upset with this guy I was having a hangout with last night. And in my rage, I started screen sharing documents I downloaded from the court and demanding that he looked at the evidence I was showing him and getting upset that he wasn't. So upset that I actually hit the wrong button and ended the hangout. I was that out of control in my evidence submission into this conversation. Whereas that conversation had started because a couple of weeks before this other guy I was telling you about that had put up this comment about how the IRS said that Hovind was innocent. Immediately went to, as soon as somebody said, well, no, actually he was convicted of this, or, well, here's some evidence that, he would immediately say, oh, well, you're a pedophile supporter. What, are you a pedophile too? I bet you're all pedophiles. And it amazes me how there's this vigor on one side to like, look at the evidence, please look at the evidence. And almost it gets emotional vigor towards it. Whereas the other side, very, very quickly with the anti-vaxxers, I never get to a third post. I can make one post, get a response from them. I can make another post. And then immediately, by their second response, they will say that I am a shill for the vaccine industry, that I'm on the take.
That's what
always.
Yeah.
You know? And that's the thing. Is all these things, they'll tell you, oh, you're a pedophile, you're on the take, you're deluded, whatever. They'll want to attack you personally and come up with, weave that into their fantasy of how this is a problem. And instead of presenting evidence or even looking at the evidence you're presenting and address that, it very, very quickly with them, it goes to, you know, well, you're part of it or whatever, that sort of thing.
They'll always find a way to terminate the conversation. What I mean by that is just like, you know, if they call you a shill or if they say that you're under the influence of Satan, these are methods of kind of just stymieing the conversation or halt, you know, just it gives them an excuse not to listen to you. And, you know, no matter like what kind of incorrect, like, you know, claim you're talking about, that, you know, there's some way that they'll do that. I mean, and it's not just, I mean, they can do it through calling you shills, and then they can also do it by, kind of dismissing the evidence, like with, Sandy Hook truthers, which, surprisingly, if you really look online, like 9/11 is still like, and JFK are still like the two main ones, but like I find the third most believed conspiracy these days is Sandy Hook, which well, I could say something about that I won't, because I want to stay on topic. But basically, like one thing that they'll say, for instance, is that like the school wasn't even functioning, and they'll say that like Adam Lanza didn't exist, and it's sort of like when you throw things out like that, you can't even get to other evidence, because if they don't believe these like, you know, fundamental things, then there's nowhere to go from there. And I guess just my point here is that that is always the impulse of someone who believes in bullshit and doesn't and wants to stay in that frame of mind. They will have ways of just kind of like, you know, terminating the conversation and throwing things out there that like, you know, make that gives them a reason not to listen to what you have to say.
I when we were driving down to Plymouth last week, Aaron and myself, we stopped off at Bristol to meet up with Gary Edwards, who is a YouTube user, philosopher, PhD in philosophy, and we were talking about some issues, and Aaron was sort of like, you know, talking about how you get the message across and whatever in relation to religion, and I came up with what may appear to be a trite example, but I think it sort of like has some sort of like interest behind it, and it was an incident that happened probably about 30 years ago when I was at university, and I used to play a lot of pool at my local pub, and the person I'm referring to is SS, and I call him that name because that's the name he used to chalk up on the blackboard to stand in line for the next game. And he had an odd view about the rule about whether you've got two shots on the black. Okay? And every time that he fouled, which he did regularly, he'd have an argument about this. And the rules were written on the wall, next to the board where he writes it. And so when he said, no, you haven't got two shots, I took him over and I said, look, these are the rules. And I actually read them out for him to see. And he could read them. And he looked at them and he just said, no. Now, that sort of like is an attitude I sort of like get when I'm talking to religious people. And I'm persuaded, no, you've got to talk to religious people, you've got to persuade them, you've got conversation and discussion is a good thing. Well, I always kind of think back to SS, and I think, no, it's pointless talking to them, because even if you provide them with the most fundamental evidence, there's the rules, that's what it says about whether you get two shots on the black or not, he just totally dismissed it. And I think that is a problem, isn't it? When you, both of you obviously have spoken to Christians and had conversations and debates with them. How do you deal with such a blanket attitude? Even though you can show them evidence, they will just say, no, not accepting it.
Well, in my real life, I know you just don't talk to that person, or there are just some topics that you don't bring up, but that raises a different question about, well, I approach it obviously very differently when I'm on the internet because of, you know, the chosen role here of, you know, counter apologetics and pro science education, right? Like I sometimes even seek people like that out, but then, you know, you're not trying to convince them of anything. You're not trying to sell them on anything. You're not structuring arguments to help fix them in some way. You're doing it for the entertainment of people that are watching, and then you're doing it just on the odd chance that maybe there's somebody out there that's will actually be influenced by seeing people like that exposed for just not being good thinkers. But I mean, that's two different questions, because like I say, in my normal life, when you encounter somebody like that in your neighborhood, you just steer away from that topic. I remember I met a guy at a bar one time. I was really good friends with him, but then he got into the thing shortly after Princess Diana was unfortunately killed in an accident, which I'm going to call it an accident, not because I'm on the take, but that's because what I think it is. We're sitting in the bar one day, and he leans over, he goes, you know what that was, right? He leans over, he goes, that was the queen taking care of business. Like, really? So we just didn't talk about it anymore because I don't need to get into that in my community.
You perhaps got me wrong. I was using an analogy before the days of mobile phones, before the days of the internet. And I was just referring to a specific incident where, you know, you can show someone the evidence and they're just, no. I don't know how you deal with it. Now we have a great opportunity to interact with people who still apparently just say no. I'm going to be away for a couple of minutes. Talk amongst yourselves.
Go for it.
Leave your camera running so the cats can take over. The show will now be hosted by Gog and Magog.
So let me take it back to kind of like the original thing that we were talking about, Hogtie. Do you think that, because I mentioned that one of Matt Dillahunty's go-to arguments on this episode of the Atheist Experience was, you know, if this, you're making these claims, if they were true, they should be able to, you know, they should be able to be verified through the peer review process. Do you think that was not a good, like a good point on his part?
Well, short answer, yes. I do think it is a good point. But I have to say that very much oversimplifies it, because I want to put two important limitations on it. And one is that's only for certain domains of thinking and domains of ideas. And that's like, okay, when somebody tells you that the preservatives in vaccines cause autism, if that were true, this would be something reliably demonstrated in the peer-reviewed literature. One moment. There we go. So pleasant. So when people make a statement as something that's empirically verifiable, well then, and it's something of critical social importance that should be an active area of research, then yes, then eventually it'd be discovered in the literature. And you might find, well, we do have one paper in The Lancet that says, yeah, there's implications with autism. And then you now have there's just short of 200 papers now that have investigated that same issue and have said no. You can't prove a negative. Well, in this case, you can show the confidence interval that the risk increase associated with vaccines, that is the autism risk, the risk increase is somewhere between in the 95% confidence interval that's between, you know, negative 0.5% and positive 0.6%, right? Like it's zero. There's just no increase in your autism risk. So when somebody says, well, this is a fact, this is a feature of nature, this is a feature of society or whatever, when we know we have all these journals that report on these things, then yeah, it should be that sort of thing. They should be able to point to research. And in fact, if you do research into it yourself, you look into the literature, you're going to find things that actually show them to be wrong. So in that sense, I agree with Matt Dillahunty when he says, we do have a forum for adjudicating issues when it comes to scientific discovery. But it's not true of everything, right? It's not true of, like I say, the, you know, whether or not OJ's guilty or not, you know, like there's other forums for things like that. And on that note, I find it weird when people say, why are we still talking about intelligent design? Kitzmiller v. Dover already proved that intelligent design is wrong. And it's that's seizure inducing when I hear a non-believer say that, because Kitzmiller v. Dover was specifically about the issue about whether or not intelligent design material, specifically of people and pandas, could be used legitimately as a science textbook in the science curriculum in a publicly owned school in the context, because it's a federal district court, even though it's state level thing, it was a federal education state level, but it was a federal filing. So it was a First Amendment issue, right? So that's what they were resolving. But as far as the truth of intelligent design or creationism, that was not before the court. And there's no way that Judge Jones actually was making a ruling about that. He was simply ruling about the applicability of First Amendment in terms of permitting using a booklet of people of pandas. I think I had a second qualifier, but I don't recall what it was. Sorry, what?
Yeah, what's your take on the fact, and again, I may get the details slightly incorrect. There was recently a vote in Congress that voted 50 to 49 that global warming was not human activity was not an influencing factor on global warming. And this struck me as an odd thing, because is that something that is something you can vote on?
I think
it's either a fact or it isn't. I mean, it just seems that to have a vote seems an odd thing.
I think that was somewhat misrepresented in the media. Like, there are a lot of times that a story, that some ridiculous thing will happen at some level of government, and then the media will sort of present it as being even goofier than it is. I'm trying to think of an example here. There's one in the state of Florida. I wonder how hard I should strain to think of an example here, where they were making it a very specific offense to suggest that global warming was human caused. I wish I had the details to hand a little more quickly here, but they were saying that they wanted to make it an offense, because it's the same thing like in Texas, right? If you go out and you say slanderous things about the beef industry, about ground beef or whatever meat production, that you'd actually be breaking Texas state law, and they see that as a reasonable limitation to freedom of speech. So Florida was doing the same thing about global warming and stuff, and the media reported that as, well, the Florida state legislature just decided that global warming isn't anthropocentric, and no, they were not ruling that. They were making a matter of public policy about saying things that might serve to hurt the resource sector of their economy. I'm not familiar with the specific vote. I do recall hearing sort of stories passing by that while they were, the United States Senate was saying that they're accepting that climate change has happened. I think this was their Science and Technology Committee was saying that climate change has happened or is happening, that they were saying it's not proven that it's human caused. But as far as what was the nature of that vote, like this is the kind of thing that I like to go back and see what motion was on the floor. Like, anytime they have a vote, like what motion was on the floor. And by the way, I'm not saying that it didn't happen that way. I'd have to look into it and see what happened. I'm not saying it didn't happen that way, because there are cases. It was a state board of education or city councilwoman. I can't remember where it was, but this was about 3 years ago. The chair had put to vote the age of the earth. They were deciding about school textbooks. And they were like, look, can we just for simplicity, let's just decide how old the earth is. And they put it to vote, and they agreed that the earth was between 6,000 and 7,000 years old. And like I say, it was a city council. Yeah, in a particular state board of education. So for the purposes of interacting in this state with regard to education, the world is 6,000 years old. Like, they have a lot of dud. I mean, you and I, DPR, have discussed this before, that the Americans have a lot of dud legislation. They do a lot of things to entertain the folks back home. They'll put in these ridiculous laws. Did you actually hear? That wasn't legislation. But like, NOM now has filed these restraining orders against these two justices of the United States Supreme Court, enjoining them against ruling on matters related to marriage issues. The two women on the – oh, you hadn't heard this. Oh, this is gold. Yeah, this is going to be a slight topic diversion, but we should get back.
Yeah, sure. Let's go with it.
This is a really interesting one. So NOM, the – is it National Organization for Marriage or something? But it's they're typical – I mean, they're not for marriage. They're just pro-bigots. They have set up a campaign where they will – for a small donation, they will deliver from you to the United States Supreme Court – and I forgot the name of the two women, Ginsburg, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and the other one, whatever, the two women, enjoining them against making any rulings on gay marriage, because they have a track record of ruling sort of liberally in a way that is, it works like any other restraining order where you say, you know, you, Mr. Jones, or not you, Jones. I'm sorry, I forgot your name was DPR Jones. I'm going to pick someone else's name. Well, I'm going to use your name. You have a demonstrated track record of causing this problem for this woman in your neighborhood. So on that basis, this court is going to issue an order saying that you are not to do any of the following things. And that is all the stuff you've been doing. Plus, in addition to that, we're going to say you have to stay, you know, 150 feet away from
Hogtie, I've got loads of them, but they're mainly in relation to children.
Okay. It's funny, one of the comments went by. Anyway, so that's sort of the basis of restraining order. They're saying that these two women on the two justices on the United States Supreme Court have a history of ruling so poorly on the issue of marriage rights that they ought to be enjoined against any further rulings on it. And so private citizens now can do these little court order things, and NOM will, for a small fee, will go ahead and deliver them. According to NOM, there are 300,000 such of these restraining orders. It's represented by, there's a famous photo of them standing outside ready to deliver these things. The boxes are empty, actually. I don't know how they actually delivered them, but the boxes are just there for demonstration. They say $300,000. The restraining order is... they would deliver it for you for a donation of $50. So that's interesting. To what effect? How many restraining orders from Johnny Lunchpail and Sally Housecoat do we need to give to Supreme Court justices to bar them from ruling on matters that they have given leave for appeal? Is it 300,000? I would have to look up in their constitution to see what the cutoff is. Because I think the answer is, it doesn't fucking matter.
Yeah. I don't know.
This is also in the same week that another story came out in the States where one, I wish I could remember the names of these guys now, but one of the congressmen has actually submitted a bill that would serve to make it against the law for another specifically named congressman from submitting bills for review by the by the Congress. and it's the same thing. It reads like a restraining order because it's like, when you look at the history of dumbass bills that this guy has put before this House, he just, like, we could still let him vote, but he just should not be allowed to put bills unless he comes and asks me first. And that bill's up for vote. It's got to go to committee. Like... It's a loony country.
Guys, I have a question kind of, relating sort of tangentially to this. Do you think that there's some sort of mechanism that could be put in place that, because, like, basically we're at the whim of the, politicians, what they believe the science to be. Is there any way that we could kind of, rather than have them using their own discernment. Is there any way that we could, have something in place that kind of says, look, this is what the truth probably is, so operate from this? I guess not. I mean, it would be nice if there was something like that, because then we wouldn't have a lot of them. Go ahead. Yeah.
I have fantasized about such thing for a long time. And sorry, your video was frozen, so I don't know if you're still with us or there you go. You're back. I'll start again. I fantasized about such a thing for a long time. Oh, you might be on mute. Okay. Well, he's with us. He's not with us.
Carry on. I think he's...
I'll carry on. Okay. I have, for some time, wish that there was such a thing, and not for every little issue, but that there should be like a registry. I mean, I know that the Canadian government is pretty famous for doing this. They have very accessible websites for if you need some information about something, you can just go do this. In one of the shows I was doing about a week ago, we started talking about whether or not the income tax system is voluntary. And somebody had sent to me a link to it's a gc.ca, or Government of Canada website. And there's a web page up there that the CRA, the Canadian Revenue Agency, web page up there on their official tax forms website that's like, here's, it's a fact on tax myths. And, isn't it true true that the tax system is voluntary? And they go, well, not really. So part of my tax dollars actually went to fund somebody to write this article, both in English and French, to explain to people that, yes, you really are supposed to pay your taxes. But there are a lot of those. The Canadian government's pretty good about having these websites up with these government services on, look, we're just going to tell you there's stuff up there about climate change and things like that. And I've always thought, wouldn't it be good if there's just like a general ministry that just overall handled like what's true and what's not? And it wasn't, as I was thinking this through, and I thought, well, a good name, we could have like a ministry, we have Ministry of Transportation, Ministry of Health, we should have a Ministry of Truth. And then I went, oh no. Because like literally it's not even like a parallel of something Orwell wrote. It's actually, I accidentally recognized that it's literally was in the book 1984. How do we have a process for truth? And the thing is, we kind of do. And then we have this thing now where Google apparently subscribes to some service that helps filter websites based on which is more plausibly true or not. And well, who becomes the adjudicator for that? I think these things can be done. I mean, I think we'll joke about it. I think we all should be wary when we have a government ministry that decides what's true and what's not. But I don't have a problem with the Canadian government do it, because for many years now, there's been a climate of transparency in the Canadian government. So if they put something up and they say, well, we think climate change is real and we think it's human caused. If you write them a letter and be like, well, what's behind this? Or if you just go to their website and be like, seriously, why do you think that? They'll be like, oh, here. And they'll give you all the information yourself. They'll give you just volumes of information on what they based it on. Who was on the committee that decided this? I want to write them a sternly worded letter, you know? So I don't know. I would kind of like to have a service like that, but as long as Canada ran it.
We're coming up to 2 hours, and I just want to make a couple of quick announcements. If you are watching this on YouTube after it's been posted live, check out the links below. We're doing the show not on Google Hangouts, not live on YouTube, but this will be uploaded. Onto YouTube within the next 24 hours. But if you want to watch the show live, follow the link below to Vaughan TV. That's where we're doing it at the moment. And the reason we are is because we don't like Hangouts, and this gives us better ability to do various bits and pieces, one of which I want to do. This is never seen before footage of Aaron in the United Kingdom. Do you want to see it, boys?
Yeah.
That's the response I wanted. I could have expected a response from Hogtie as well.
I was nodding vigorously, but muted.
Let me give you a bit of background to this. Aaron obviously knew he was coming here for some months, and I would be taking him around and whatever. And I said to him, okay, you've got 3 days in London. What is it that you want to do in London? And I expected him to, well, I kind of didn't expect him, I suppose, but I thought he may say Houses of Parliament, Buckingham Palace, and what. No, none of that. There were only three things he wanted to do in London. One was the Natural History Museum, which we did. The second was going to Charles Darwin's house, Down House, which we did, and the pictures of that on his Facebook page. But the other was, he wanted to go to Crystal Palace Park. Now, for those that are not familiar with London, Crystal Palace Park is sort of like east, and there's just nothing there, except for one small little island. And on that island, in a lake, there were a collection of dinosaurs that were put together by a person called Sir Richard Owens in about 1850s, around that sort of time. And apparently Aaron has wanted to visit these since the age of about 11. So for 40 years or more, he's been wanting to see these. And I looked on the internet, and I just thought, why does he want to see them? But he was absolutely insistent he had to go there. So we went there. And I told him beforehand, and I think he probably knew this, you can't get up close and personal with them because they're on this island. No. Let me see if I can set the scene. By if you're watching...
Sorry, what island are you talking about? In Lower Lake? Where is it?
This is in Crystal Palace Park.
Yeah, but which island are you talking about? This is like in the southeast part of London. There's no island anywhere.
Can you see the picture on Vaughan now?
Yes.
It's a park. It's got sort of like a lake. There's a little island.
Oh, down by the sidewalks. Okay, so Lower Lake.
Yeah.
Like to the east of the Quidditch field or whatever that thing is.
Yeah. Whatever. Whatever.
I don't know. I've never been to your country.
But
I know where the sidewalks are. I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
But Aaron joked with me the day before. He said, "Oh, when we go to Crystal Palace tomorrow, I'm going to have to take my shorts and my sandals." And I said, "Look, you can't do it. You cannot get up close and personal with these things. It's against the law. You'll be arrested." Okay. So that's a background to it. So let's have a look, shall we? If we can, what happened when Aaron actually got there. And he's been waiting 40 years for us, so I kind of understand it. But here we go. I just have to press... what do I need to press? Settings and play. There's no sound to this, but I'll be making a YouTube video about it. But anyway, here we go.
Oh, dude, what are you doing? So the duster, how common is that as outerwear?
It's unseen in this country. I don't know what it's like in America. Get the image of the poor woman. And if you had the audio, she's talking to a child. And the child's saying, "I want to see the man over there." And she's saying, "Oh, the man over there could be there for some time." So, despite the fact that he didn't have his shorts or sandals on, he just strode across the water and spent the rest... This was sort of like lunchtime. We then went to the British Museum, and he was wandering around there, sort of like leaving wet, soggy footprints wherever he went. I don't know whether people think this is fun. I just thought it was extraordinary. He was just so determined to stand next to them.
It's terrible, but I adore it. That's great.
We'll see him coming back soon.
There's a friend of mine when I was in university used to refer to doing a para illegal activity, right? Because you always felt like when you're in college, you have to do stuff that you're not supposed to do when you're a real grown up, but it can't be something that's going to really get you into trouble. So we used to talk about doing para illegal activity. Like we did go through the fountains at the legislature buildings and things like that, you know, because they come over and they chase you out and wag your finger and you're like, "Oh, we're so naughty we did that." But Aaron's not a college boy. Look how old that guy is. Huh. So there were no, I mean, the one old lady appeared to cluck her tongue, but.
Oh, there was a police officer nearby. We had to wait for him to go away before he did that. So there we go. Anyway, I'll probably put that together in a video. And also, for those that may be watching on YouTube, we're sort of like doing our best to update the show. And you will now be able to download it as a audio file from the Magic Sandwich Show. I put the last show on as an audio file. This one will be up again from www.magicsandwichshow.com. You can check it out from there. So we're pretty much up to 2 hours, and I think we've overrun slightly. But before we go, I just want to touch with you, Vadim, if I may. You talked about or learning about the Atheist Experience show about 2008, 2009, I think you said. Were you a religious person before then, or what's your background? Oh, well, that was a quick, short question that seemed to remove him entirely. I'm getting a notification there's a problem with the call. We may save that for a... Unless it comes back quickly.
He was embarrassed and ran away.
Yeah. Could be. You just ask these people one question and that's it.
Just scratch the surface.
The cowardice of their position.
I am going to, I should send this to Aaron. Do you realize that about, I lost my spot here, about 100 feet away from where he went wading through the water, there's a little bridge.
No, there's not.
He'd have had to hop the fence. Did you see it? He'd have had to hop the fence.
No, there isn't a bridge. You can't get there without crossing the water.
On the northeast corner of the island?
You can't, no.
There's like a little dam or something.
How did you find that so quickly?
Hey man, I'm a pro at this.
Yeah, obviously. No, you can't. Yeah. You're not allowed on the island. Those sort of like images, statues, whatever you want to call them, are grade one listed, which it means that you're just not allowed even to get close to them. You're not allowed to touch them. Oh, he's calling me. I can't. I think if... Oh, add to group call. Yeah, there we go.
Hello?
There we go.
Hello? Are we back?
We are back.
Fantastic. So, sorry about that. Don't know if that was a problem on my end. But, so what were you going to say, DPR?
I was just asking, were you a Christian before you sort of like came across the Atheist Experience show, or what?
Actually, I think...
Could I just pause you? Hogtie, if you could stop that, because you're messing up the entire thing. I'll have to...
Oh, I forgot your thing.
What is that? That's kind of weird.
You're going to show me the bridge where apparently he could have got across being wet.
Okay, well, there's the Quidditch field. And then down here, and that looks like the dinosaurs. So it looks like you were sort of over on this sidewalk to the west.
Yeah.
And then went over that little fence and boom there. And there, dinosaur.
But what's this thing, aren't you? Yeah, you wouldn't. You couldn't cross that bridge. Trust me. You're not allowed to do that.
That's it. Okay. Well, look,
Aaron broke the law and probably will never be accepted back in this country because he's posted his criminal activities onto YouTube and Facebook. Okay, so
I'm getting the Latin long for that bridge, and I'm going to come to your country and prove you wrong. Okay, how do I stop screen sharing? Does anybody know the tools?
Yeah, I think it's calls.
Call.
Drop down. Stop screen
video.
Sharing.
Stop. Stop my video. Share screens. Got it.
There you go.
That did not end it.
Well, I don't know what to do. I could throw you off the call and bring you back
in. I could
throw
myself off the call, but let me just try again. Share screens.
I'm sure it's under call.
Yeah, but then it gives me the option share a window or share my screen, but not, okay, please stop sharing. Remember last time I tried to end screen sharing?
Someone will type in the... I think that when you're sharing screens, it may appear in the bottom right-hand corner.
Found it. It's in the mini window. Stop sharing. Yeah. There we go. Look how easy that was.
There we go. Job done. So, Vadim, for the third time, I apologize about that. So tell us a bit about your background. I'm always curious for people who've never been on the show before.
Sure. Well, I think I have kind of a different background than most. I grew up mostly under the influence of kind of the ideas of my mom. And I would say that she kind of believes a lot of new agey woo type beliefs, and I definitely grew up believing kind of in things like crystals, reincarnation. Basically, I think that what I believed was sort of a grab bag of things that sounded nice to me, you know, in retrospect. And I'm around 40 now. And when I hit 30, I started having more of a skepticism towards a lot of these ideas. But I don't know. It was really when I watched The Atheist Experience, it's like when I watched those clips, I started watching a lot of clips. I kind of binge watched it. And I realized, like, okay, not only was 9/11 not an inside job, but there probably isn't a God either. You know, I always had kind of I did have a belief in God, but it was not like the Christian kind of concept of God. I actually, at a very young age, I thought that Christianity was bullshit. A story that my mom likes to retell me is apparently when I was very young, like around 7 or 8, probably like a year after I learned to read, my mom had a book from that was written by a friend of hers that was about, like, you know, this woman was a Christian who, like, believed in, she was like a fundamentalist. And she said that I picked up her book and I was reading the back of it. And mind you, what I'm about to tell you was not in my typical character, but, like, you know, I was reading about the book and I just flung it across the room and said, "This is bullshit." So I think I actually had kind of like a knee jerk, like, reaction to most religions when I was young, that, you know, that I thought that they instinctually that they were kind of ridiculous.
Somebody has put in the chat, ends with a question mark. They say, "You're American, aren't you?" Question mark. I'm not asking you to say whether you are or not, but if you're comfortable in answering that question.
No, I don't mind. I grew up, I was born in LA, and then I grew up mostly in New York, like high school and stuff. But, I wouldn't say that I grew up at all, like, you know, in kind of like a very religious area. You know, I didn't grow up in like the Southwest or the South, where that's much more, kind of common. But I live now. I've been in Florida the past few years, and I am in kind of an area where it's pretty religious. In fact, there's a sign on the highway about 5 miles away from here that says, "An eternity in hell is a long time!" Exclamation point. That's all it says.
That's awesome.
It is pretty awesome and pretty horrifying at the same time. But I just letting you know, kind of my background as a child. I did have these predominantly like woo kind of beliefs. I also I grew up with my grandparents in my household, and I actually didn't even know what religion was until my first day of first grade, and I started school kind of a year early. So, you know, I was young at this time, and I think this is a good story. I think you guys will like this. Basically, my first day of school, all these came up to me, and it was just a series of kids whose hands I shook, and each kid said, like, you know, told me their name, and they asked, like, one of the first questions was, "What religion are you?" And I don't think I had even heard the term. And I had heard certain kids saying that they were Jewish, and for some reason, you know, I knew that my name was Russian, and for some reason I thought all Russians were Jews. Like, I think it was like the name, the words sounded similar to me. So I think that's how I like reasoned it at the time. So by the end of the day, I was going up to kids saying, "Hi, my name is Vadim." My teacher called my home because she thought something was weird. And she spoke with my grandmother, and she said, is your son or your grandson Jewish? And my grandmother was very ethnocentric, okay? Like, she I guess you could say she was probably a little bigoted towards Jews and probably anyone that was not a WASP. And basically, when I came home that day, she was livid. And she like took me by the arms. And the first thing that she said was, Vadim, you are not Jewish. You are a WASP. And I had no clue what the fuck a wasp was. Like, in my mind, I was thinking, what? I'm an insect? What the fuck are you talking about? You know, so that was like my first, that was like really my first introduction to religion in general. And I think that, like, I don't know if I, like, I think at least subconsciously that day, I kind of realized that, like, religion was kind of bullshit. Like, just the whole feeling that I got from everything, it felt like a ritual that people were doing, that they were just told to say these things, you know? I mean, like, it was weird how all of these kids, just every single one of them asked, what are you? And I think that they had been told by their parents, like, ask everyone what religion they are and, you know, stick with the Jews or stick with the Catholics, you know, whatever the that they happen to be. So anyhow, I hope, does that sort of shed light on my background? I mean, I definitely didn't have like a typical experience. And, you know, I'd say that that's kind of like my youth. And yeah,
I think
do you have any questions?
I think it sheds a lot of light on it. I think it helps too for international viewers that maybe from you know, parts of the world where that's not how you introduce yourself. It's not normally the first thing you find out about somebody. I've heard this from other Americans that there's a lot of that sense of identity that just sort of comes from religion, and they're asked about it, and you sort of get that, and you're sort of okay, like even if you're a different religion. I mean, if you know. As long as it's not something weird like Jehovah's Witness or Mormon, like you're generally accepted. As long as you're a Christian, you know, whatever. And they even don't have so much of a problem with Muslim families moving in. They try to be reasonably open-minded about that. But when non-believers make the claim that they're in a community somewhere and it came out that they were an atheist and they were starting to be treated poorly by other people, often religious folk will say, well, that's ridiculous. Like why are atheists complaining about, oh, they're victims to stuff and whatnot? And I think sometimes, you know, for people in other countries, they don't realize that it's hard to be an atheist in communities like that, where part of your introduction and identity hinges on your group membership. And additionally, their understanding of atheism and atheists as a group is not a pleasant one at all. And when your kids go to school and then somebody says, well, what religion are you? Unless your six-year-old is willing to lie and say, oh, well, I'm, you know, Reformed Southern Baptist Reformation of 1784, like they've got to come up with some religion that they claim they're part of. Because if the kid says, oh no, we don't go to church, well, that your children are treated poorly by other children. And just to sort of, for contrast, I'll say very briefly, I think most people heard this already, but I mean, where I grew up, this was not an issue. Like we have Catholics and we have Protestants. And, I didn't know if you started telling me about Jewish people when I was a kid, you may as well have been telling me about some alien civilization on Star Trek. Because I didn't know that there were Jewish people, that they had different rules. Apparently they can't eat milk and meat at the same time or whatever. These were completely foreign concept to me as a kid, because we never had things like that. And of course, there were Muslims, but they were all terrorists, right? But as far as my community went, that's all there were, was Catholics and Protestants, and there certainly were no atheists. That just didn't make sense. And there were Hutterites.
Yeah, that's... sort of akin to my recollections, but atheism wasn't an option as a child.
Mm.
It's interesting you mentioned that. But I think that may be a topic for a future show. I think we're going to wrap it up, if that's all right with everyone.
Sure.
Trying to see how long we... Yeah, we've overrun by 20 minutes, but hey, what the hell.
Always fun, yeah.
Just to remind people... if you're watching this on YouTube, which the majority of you are going to be doing, check out the link below for the Vaughan TV channel, because that's where you're going to see it live, and that's where you can interact and chat and whatever. And I've been watching some of the chat, and it's been entertaining, as it always is. So Yeah, this will be up on YouTube within the next 24 hours, I hope. You can also download it as an audio file by going to the Magic Sandwich Show website. And we'll see you in 2 weeks' time. Final words,
thank you all. I nothing to add. I had a lot of fun. It's very nice to meet you, Vadim.
Definitely. I had a blast, guys. Thanks so much for having me on.
Thank you very much. I'll end the show.